Good morning, everyone. Today I'm going to teach you about beams, bending stresses, shear stresses, and torsional stresses, and elastic constants. These are the topic today I'm going to cover you. First, beam. What is beam? Beam is nothing but a horizontal member subjected to transverse loading on it. Suppose take this is a beam. Beam is nothing but a horizontal member subjected to transverse loading. Due to this transverse loading, the beam bends like this. You can see here is a this is called neutral layer. This is the longitudinal axis of the beam and this is the cross sectional axis of the beam. Okay, in the cross sectional axis you can see that this is nothing but neutral axis. This is the difference between the neutral layer and the neutral axis. Neutral layer will be in the longitudinal axis of the section and neutral axis will be in the cross section of the beam. Now what is meant by beam? A beam is nothing but a member, horizontal member. You can see in a structure there are large number of beams and columns and footings and foundation. Generally the load transfer mechanism in the structure will be like from beams there will be like transverse loading. From beams the loads will be transferred to columns. From columns the load will be transferred to the footings. From footings, the load will be transferred into the subsoil structure. Okay, that's why we will study the beam and how many loads it can suffer and what will be strength, what will be compressive stresses, and what will be tensile stresses. You can see the beam bends like this. Due to this bending, there will be bending moment. Due to this bending moment, there will be like the beam bends like this. You can see a pack of cards like this. If they bends due to this bending, topmost fiber will be subjected to compressive stresses and bottommost fiber will be subjected to tensile stresses. You can see a small element here, compressive stresses, here tensile stresses. You can see the neutral layer will be subjected to zero stresses. There will be no stress on the neutral layer. While we go towards this tensile stresses one, I am just giving you a number, say 3. That means bottommost fiber is subjected to tensile stress of magnitude 3 newtons. You can say like 3 newtons. Similarly, when you go upper direction, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. That means topmost fiber will be subjected to compressive stress of minus 3 magnitude. I am taking like tension as positive and compression as negative. You can take in otherwise vice versa. Okay. Now see, you can take axis, x axis, y axis. This is nothing but 2D plane and z axis is nothing but it is towards you, facing you. This is the plane. This is the plane is nothing but z axis. You can see the beam, the definition of the beam I am going to write you here. A beam is nothing but horizontal member. Subjected to transverse loading. Where? Now that this is the main important. Where? The vectorial representation of forces, moments will be perpendicular to the axis of beam or member. Now you can see that beam is nothing but a horizontal member substitute to the transverse loading, where the vectorial representation of the forces moments will be the perpendicular to the axis of the member, perpendicular to this longitudinal axis of the beams. Now see, keep your hand, right hand like this, and beam is bending like this. By bending like this, you can see the vectorial notation, the thumb represents the vectorial representation will be along the z axis, that means along the perpendicular to the longitudinal axis. And the vectorial notation of the forces also will be in the perpendicular to the longitudinal axis. So this is the very important information of the beam. And due to this bending, there will be like bending stresses. If you take this cross section, this is a neutral layer, you can see it will be subjected to, bottommost part will be subjected to compressive stresses and topmost will part to subjected to tensile stresses. Due to this, there will be a diagram. This topmost part for compressive stresses. As you go on near the neutral axis, you can see the bending stress will become zero. And as you go from the topmost fiber, you can see the bending stresses will be maximum. Compressive stresses, tensile stresses. Compressive stresses are represented by left arrow and tensile stresses are represented by right arrow. You can see this is the bending stress diagram. Now main equations to find the bending stress, we will use M by I equal to F by Y equal to E by R. To find bending stresses, we will use this known as bending equation or flexural equation. M by I equal to F by Y equal to E by R. Here M is nothing but bending moment, I is nothing but moment of inertia, F is nothing but bending stress, Y is nothing but distance of the topmost fiber from the neutral axis, and E is nothing but Young's modulus, and R is nothing but it's a radius of curvature. We can say that radius of curvature, R is nothing but radius of curvature. This is about the beam. Next we will go about the shaft and torsion stress. Before you have studied about the beam, now we will study about the torsion. You can see shaft here, circular shaft, subjected to the torsion T, a torque T. Now, how will the stresses will develop? Now, we will see. Now, keep your, this is the longitudinal axis of the shaft. This is the cross section of the axis of the shaft, longitudinal axis. Now you can see, because of the torque, keep your right hand in the direction of the torque and rotate it. You can see the vectorial representation of the torque will be along the axis of the shaft. The shaft rotate like this, you can direct these arrows inwards. The shaft is rotating like this, you can direct the arrows like pointing outwards of the longitudinal axis of the shaft. It's your ways. Okay. Due to this torsion, there will be distortion in the cross section of the shaft. Like if you are like distortion of the cross section. One equation like bending equation is, this is known as torsional equation. Here nothing but T by J equal to shear stress by R equal to N theta by L. To solve this torque, J is nothing but polar moment of inertia. Nothing but J equal to IHS plus IYY. Moment of inertia in H direction plus moment of inertia in Y direction is nothing but polar moment of inertia J. T by J equal to shear stress by R equal to n theta by L. N is nothing but resistivity modulus. Theta is nothing but angle in radians. L is nothing but length of the member. This tau is nothing but shear stress. R is nothing but radius. These are the things. Now we study about. Now we study about the bending stress we have studied, torsional stress we have studied. Now what is meant by shear stress, I will tell you. See. Suppose, take a bar, half length L, subjected to this vertical loading or transverse loading. I am cutting the member here. You can see after the cut, the member will develop internal forces to resist this transverse load. These all internal forces will be nothing but, these all internal forces will be along the plane, not perpendicular to the plane, but like normal stress. These all internal forces will be along the cross section, that is parallel to cross section. These are nothing but shear forces. Without taking all these different forces, we will take as one average force, shear stress average force. Nothing but shear force. Shear force upon shearing area. That means nothing but cross section area. This is nothing but shear force. If you take a little element here, little element I am taking here. This side will be subjected to shear stress tau. To maintain this in equilibrium, this side the stress should be tau. And to maintain this, now you see, equal and opposite forces subjected to the distance, there will be torque. So the element will be subjected to this anti-clockwise rotation. To balance this rotation, you need clockwise direction torque. So I am taking this. This all will be, this is nothing but shear stress rotational equilibrium. So in shear stress always there will be like rotational equilibrium will be there to satisfy it. Now see the element due to this shear stress, how will be distortion. See, this will be subjected to like this stress. This side will be subjected to like this stress. So distortion will be like some rhombus shape. Distortion of the element after the shear stress, before the shear stress. So I am taking this as strain from before direction. So shear stress is nothing but directly proportional to shear strain. So G, nothing but resistivity modulus, is the ratio of shear stress upon shear strain. Okay. Now we can see one important topic in shear stress. No, nothing but Young's modulus. We'll talk you about this elastic constants. Our first elastic constant would be Young's modulus, E. Young's modulus, in the stress strain curve of the mild steel, if the specimen is subjected to the specimen of steel, we can take as a dumbbell shape. If you keep it in UTM, universal testing mission, it will be subjected to tensile loading. Due to this tensile loading, we will get stress strain curve of this steel material, ductile material. In the stress strain curve, we will get a curve like this. These are the core. Up to we will take this as a we will take this as a elastic limit up to OA is nothing but elastic limit, OB is nothing but proportional limit. In the proportionality limit, you can see here theta, theta nothing but is linear zone. This is not nothing but elastic zone. This is nothing but proportionality limit. Up to this zone, this is known as elastic zone. This is known as plastic zone. In the elastic zone, if the load removed, the material will come in the its actual position. In the plastic region, if the load is removed, it will not come to its original shape. That is not my plastic. That is not my A. This is not my elastic. So here theta is nothing but slope divided by dx, stress by strain. Nothing but theta is nothing but n modulus. N modulus is strain. So according to the Hooke's law, we can write as stress is directly proportional to strain. And Young's modulus constant is nothing but that implies stress equal to constant into strain. So Young's modulus is equal to stress by strain. Similarly, before we have studied that rigidity modulus equal to shear stress upon shear strain. Now the third one will be like bulk modulus. What is meant by bulk modulus? The third one will be bulk modulus. This will come in the hydrostatic case, hydrostatic loading. That will be x axis, there will be loading, y axis, there will be loading, z axis will be loading. You can see here. Remember, subjected to triaxial loading. Triaxial means in three directions the loading will be there. Sigma x, sigma y, sigma z. Due to this triaxial loading, there will be like volumetric strain. Because in x, if you can see here, if a element is subjected to only uniaxial load, like this ductile specimen in the UTM, universal testing machine, it is subjected to only uniaxial loading. Due to this uniaxial loading, there will be stress in the one direction only, uniaxial direction only. I am taking this as x axis, only one direction, the uniaxial loading. Due to this, strain will be there. Strain in x axis equal to sigma x by E. Strain in x direction nothing but sigma x by E. We have studied strain equal to stress by Young's modulus. We have seen that Young's modulus is equal to stress by strain. So strain equal to stress by Young's modulus. So in uniaxial loading, the strain in that direction will be stress upon Young's modulus. Okay. This is nothing but volumetric strain. The bulk modulus is represented by a symbol K. Bulk modulus equal to change in pressure upon volumetric strain. Okay. Change in pressure upon volumetric strain. Now I will talk about this volumetric strain just in the after Poisson's ratio. Now you can see fourth one is about Poisson's ratio. Poisson's ratio. Poisson's ratio nothing but it is noted by the symbol mu. Poisson's ratio nothing but lateral strain upon linear or longitudinal strain. This is the definition of the Poisson's ratio. Now I will see why it is important and what is the important in it. Suppose you take a member and subject it to this axial loading P. The member will strain in the this longitudinal direction, but the member will also strain in the perpendicular direction, that is in the y axis, but it will subject it to a compression and this will be subjected to. You can see after the load is removed, you can see there will be tension. So the beam elongates in the x direction, but the beam will subject it to elongation in vertical direction also, but is that negative elongation, that means nothing but compression. So strain in x direction equal to sigma h by e. This is nothing but uniaxial case. But in the triaxial case, that means if subjected to three forces, sigma y, sigma z, if the element is subjected to three directions, and Poisson's ratio is telling nothing but elastic strain in the lateral strain, nothing but y, by linear strain, nothing but in the x direction. This is nothing but Poisson's ratio. What is Poisson's ratio telling? So, if the element is subject to triaxial loading, then we should write strain in x direction as three axis loading. Sigma h by e minus nothing but y direction strain, I am writing as minus mu times of sigma h. That means minus mu times of sigma h by e minus mu times of sigma z by e. Same. Sigma h by e. So this will come as sigma x equal to sigma x by e into 1 minus 2 mu. I am taking here sigma x equal to sigma y equal to sigma z. This is an important condition. I am taking here also sigma x equal to sigma y equal to sigma z. Therefore, sigma strain x direction becomes sigma x by e into 1 minus 2 mu. Similarly, sigma y equal to sigma x by e into 1 minus 2 mu. So, volumetric strain, nothing but strain in x axis plus strain in y axis plus strain in z axis equal to 3 sigma x by e into 1 minus 2 mu. Or you can write here sigma x plus sigma y plus sigma z by e into 1 minus 2 mu, where sigma x and sigma y and sigma z are not equal. In that case, you can write sigma x plus sigma y plus sigma z by e into 1 minus 2 mu. This is nothing but volumetric strain. And now, why the Poisson's ratio is that much important? Because for any element you take, if it is subjected to tensile loading, we must know that in perpendicular axis how much will be strain also. Not only this longitudinal strain, due to this longitudinal strain, there will be also lateral strain also. The lateral strain also we need to know of any material, because you can see in cork, this mu value varies from 0 to 0.5. Poisson's ratio varies from 0.5. Mu is 0 for cork. That means if a member is subjected to along the one axis stress, the member will not strain in the perpendicular direction. What is use? Before, cork is nothing but strain is 0. That means Poisson's ratio is 0. Sorry. That means in the lateral, there will be no lateral strain. So, if you take a cork, this is used in the like cap for vines, so that there will be no lateral strain. So, that is the important of this Poisson's ratio. Okay, tagging you.